Well, it's a great pleasure and privilege for me to introduce Professor Keith Runcorn tonight. And Keith was educated in universities of Manchester and Cambridge. And then since then, he's been educating us about how the Earth and the solar system works. And he did pioneering work in the applications of paleomagnetism to continental drift. And he did this at a time when it wasn't, you know, particularly fashionable to tell people that, say, North America and Europe were moving apart from each other. And we're very fortunate to have him speak to us tonight on Galileo and the Pope, some reflections on the philosophy of science. And I want to emphasize that, you know, Professor Runcorn stuck to his guns a few decades ago about this business of continental drift. And he's been since proven right. So unlike Galileo, he hasn't had to recant. So with that, I'll turn the floor over to Professor Runcorn.
Thank you very much. I'm glad to be speaking here and seeing in the audience quite a few old friends. Could I have the first slide? The centenary of the birth of Einstein was celebrated in 1978, and the present Pope, on that occasion, wanting to make a gesture to science, said that he would set up a commission to thoroughly investigate the Galileo question again. And I think that one reason for his move was that there'd been a number of books published about Galileo, and in one of them there seemed to be evidence that the records of the trial of Galileo had been tampered with in the Vatican archives. And so consequently, the commission the Pope set up to consider the Ptolemaic Copernican controversies of the 16th and 17th century had sub-commissions, one dealing with the various legal questions, and of course one dealing with the scientific, and another with the theological and philosophical questions. Well, it took this commission about 12 years to write its report, and as you see, in 1992, the Pope, at the regular biennial meeting of the Pontifical Academy of Science, talked about the work of this commission, and it was reported in the press and created quite a lot of interest. But what I'm going to talk about tonight, of course, is what the bearing of the these controversies on the philosophy of science. Now, this is a photograph, of course, of St. Peter's, and behind it are the Vatican Gardens. This is Bernini's colonnade. And in one of the buildings that you see there is the headquarters of the Pontifical Academy of Science. It had a long and interesting history. It originated in the group of scientists who got together in Galileo's day, forming the Accademia Lincei, which is now the Academy of the Italian State. Society, therefore, or this academy, predates the Royal Society of London, which was founded in 1662, but it hasn't had a continued existence. After the Galileo trial and the blow that that delivered to science in Italy, it was disbanded. It was revived by Pope Pius IX in the 1830s. And then, of course, after Garibaldi unified Italy and Rome was occupied in 1870, the reformed Accademia Lincei then became the Academy of the Italian, of the new Italian state. The Pope didn't recognize the conquest of Rome, and the situation remained as an impasse, the Pope declaring himself a prisoner of the Vatican. And it was only around 1930 that the matter was settled, and Mussolini gave the Pope the Vatican City. And then in 1935, this academy was revived by the Pope as the Pontifical Academy of Science. The next slide shows the rather splendid summer palace of one of the 16th century popes, Pius IV, which in 1935 was made the headquarters of the Pontifical Academy, and this is the academicians and others who were at this meeting. The next slide. Well, I said in the abstract that the newspapers made quite a splash, and on the morning of the Pope's speech, the London Times came out with an article on the left and a leader, and the Daily Mail, the more popular paper, found a rather good headline. Now, it's not my intention, of course, to defend the Roman Catholic Church, which behaved very badly over Galileo, but it's not quite true, as you'll see, that Galileo was not exonerated until the report of this commission in 1992. The next slide. The story, of course, of the controversy goes back to Copernicus, and Copernicus was born exactly halfway between the fall of Constantinople in 1473 and the discovery of America in 1493. He died 70 years after his birth, that is in 1534, it was only on his deathbed that he was presented with the printed copy, printed in Germany, of his great work, Revolutionibus Orbium Celestium. And Copernicus was, of course, Polish, and he was born in Tehran, educated in Krakow University, and he went with his brother, apparently walking all the way, to study in northern Italy in the University of Bologna. And this, of course, was several decades after the fall of Constantinople. And so the Renaissance had begun. The ancient astronomical works were being passed around, and probably Copernicus there read about the ideas that had been mooted by the Greeks, that the sun was at the center of the solar system. However, Aristotle and Ptolemy had produced a model of the solar system in which the Earth was fixed at the center, the fixed stars, fixed to what they called a crystal sphere, we would, I suppose, think of it as a perspex globe, were rotating once in each sidereal day. This was the prime mover. And within this sphere of the fixed stars were other crystal spheres, one containing the sun, one the moon, and the others the planets. And this very straightforward model had been based on Aristotelian physics, the idea that circular motion required no explanation. And of course, in about 200 AD, Ptolemy in Alexandria modified this scheme in order to represent the motions of the planets more accurately by inserting in this model of circular motions other circular motions which were called epicycles. And the purpose of Ptolemy's model was to explain what had always puzzled the early astronomers, that at certain times when the Earth, as we now know, overtakes the outer planets Mars, Jupiter and Saturn on its interior track, these planets appear to move backwards relative to the fixed stars. And so Ptolemy's model was, if you like, a rather elaborate trick to reconcile the idea that the planets were moving round circles at uniform speed with what was observed. And what he did, of course, was to have the planets outside the Earth's orbit rotate on circles, the centers of which were attached to these crystal spheres. Copernicus saw quite early in his life that this elaborate model of Ptolemy's could be very greatly simplified by supposing that the sun and not the Earth was at the center, and that the backward movement, the retrogression, as it's called, of Mars, Jupiter, and Saturn, was simply the result of the Earth overtaking them on an interior path. And also the rather odd behavior of the inferior planets, Venus and Mercury, also had simple explanations on the heliocentric model. Now, this is the city of Turin, where Copernicus was born. And the next pair of slides shows Poland at that time. It was a kingdom, but the German knights controlled a good deal of this, of what was, of course, East Prussia. And Copernicus's uncle was the bishop of a diocese here, more or less an independent ruler. And the cathedral of this diocese was on the coast. Frauenberg was the German name. Fromberg is the present Polish name. You see that the Poles were not aware that perhaps the greatest scientist of all time was born in Turin, I find this rather a pleasant slide that Napoleon had to point it out to them on his way to Moscow. The next slide. The cathedral of Frauenberg on the coast of the Baltic was surrounded by the wall. And after Copernicus returned from studying in Italy, his uncle appointed him the canon of the cathedral. He was really the bishop's assistant, and also he'd learned sufficient about medicine to be his doctor. And Copernicus remained in and around Frauenberg for the rest of his long life. He early set about making astronomical observations. This is the famous tower where he lived, in the wall of the cathedral. And he wasn't a particularly good observer, and the observations that, and it probably wasn't a very good climate for astronomical observations, and in fact almost all of the observations that he used were Greek, of almost over 1,000 years before. The next slide. This is another picture of the tower. One must remember that such observations as he did were done without the telescope, which was discovered in 1609. And this painting indicates that the observations which were made by sighting devices. The next slide. Now, Copernicus,
or just pull it over.
Copernicus
published a short account of his ideas, but the slide on the left shows the famous picture from the book De Revolutionis Orbium Celestum. And you see, of course, this is the fixed stars. Here's the Sun, Mercury, Venus, the Earth, with the Moon orbiting the Earth, and Mars, Jupiter, and Saturn. Those, of course, were the only planets known until just over 200 years ago, Sir William Herschel discovered Uranus. And as I said a little earlier, this system very neatly explains the apparent backward movement of these planets when the Earth is moving in this part of its orbit. And of course, it explains why Venus is sometimes seen in the morning and sometimes after sunset, and why both Mercury and Venus only make a relatively small angle with the Sun. In the case of Venus, not more than just over 40 degrees. This shows the Ptolemaic system, and here, of course, is the Earth at the center, and these are the various epicycles, circular motions, which enable Ptolemy to give a reasonable account of the planetary motions. Now, one difficulty strikes the reader of Copernicus's life. Why, having done this early work, becoming convinced of the heliocentric system, did he keep back publication until the last year or two of his life? And many people, of course, have assumed that it was fear of persecution by the Roman Catholic Church. But in fact, he was encouraged by the local bishops. He also was encouraged by the Pope at the time. Of course, the reform of the calendar made Rome very much aware of the importance of astronomy, and Copernicus took part in the discussions which led to the reform of the calendar. And it's a matter of speculation as to why he was slow to publish, but I think it is likely that as he, in youth, became a convert to the heliocentric system, and as he gradually worked on the difficult mathematical problems of exactly explaining the motion of the planets according to this scheme, he found himself being forced to add little epicycles himself. And in fact, he found that in order to represent the motions of the planets, he had to make the center of their circular motions. He never moved away from Aristotle's belief in the fundamental character of circular motions, but he found that you had to put the center of the planetary orbits a little distance from the Sun. And So it seems to me probable that he became disappointed that his heliocentric theory didn't turn out as beautiful as he imagined in youth. His manuscript was only published because of the entreaties of a young German professor, Reiticus, who took the manuscript back to Germany and had it published. Although the work is dedicated to the Pope at the time, there is a mysterious preface which was assumed to be written by Copernicus until Kepler found out that it had been inserted by a German theologian, Osiander. And in this preface, the writer makes the point that this is purely a mathematical model, as we would call it, designed to better explain the motions of the planets, and mustn't be taken as physically real. The Osiander apparently put it in because he was already beginning to guess that trouble lay ahead with the theologians, who had taken the Aristotle-Ptolemy cosmology and kind of integrated it into a universal doctrine, which included the Bible as God's word. And it was not hard for theologians to find in the Bible ideas that the earth was fixed, which fitted perfectly the cosmology of Ptolemy. And Osiander seemed to be a man of some vision and saw that there might later be trouble. But Copernicus himself, it seems, believed in the physical truth of his model. He was worried about ridicule from the uneducated people around him. And he saw, of course, that the skeptic could easily say, how could the earth be moving with great speed through the solar system, carrying with it not only the loose things such as trees on the Earth's surface, but carrying with it the orbiting moon. And I'll come back to this in a moment. The next slide. The slide on the left shows a view, a very accurate view, of the modern solar system. This is the Sun, Mercury, Venus, the Earth, Mars, and then of course the asteroid belt and Jupiter. This actually was prepared by the astronomers at Heidelberg to celebrate the naming of one particular asteroid after Professor Fechter of the Max Planck Institute there, and all these positions of the planets and asteroids were arranged for the day of celebration of this christening, Mercury, Venus, the Earth, and I show it because it makes very clear how the orbit of Mercury is rather strongly elliptical, as is the orbit of Mars, and one can see, of course, how Copernicus, assuming the orbits were circular, had to place their centers some little way away from the Sun. This is the tomb of Copernicus in the church in Krakow. The next slide. Well, now, I leave Copernicus for a moment because the next great astronomers in this period that we're considering were Tycho Brahe, a Danish nobleman, who for the first time since antiquity built an observatory with sufficiently carefully designed sighting instruments to greatly improve the quality of astronomical observations. And it was his very careful observations on the position of Mars that later on enabled Kepler to see that the orbits of the planets are not circles, but are ellipses. And it shows really the good fortune of nature that the planet which is most easily observed was Mars, and Mars' orbit, as I pointed out a little earlier, is, apart from Mercury and Pluto, the most elliptical in the solar system. So the improvement that Tycho Brahe made in observations, particularly of Mars, enabled Kepler to make this very important breakthrough, which is known, of course, as Kepler's three laws of planetary motion. But Kepler was born in Germany, near Stuttgart, was rather a mystic, and he began to interest himself in the Copernican system. One of the features, of course, of the Copernican system is the planets have a distance from the Sun which has certain regularities. We now know that as Bode's law. But Kepler experimented first on seeing whether he could determine the distances of the planets from the Sun by this rather curious model in which he takes the five solids known in antiquity as having faces which are equal, and he fits one of them, well, he fits the sphere corresponding to the planet's motion between a circumscribed and an inscribed regular solid. And he made these models, and they still are in existence. You see the model in the in this drawing, and as you see, Kepler thought that there was some regularity in the solar system, and his first attempt, of course, to find it did not constitute a great science and scientific advance, but it eventually brought him to the point where he discovered his three famous laws of planetary motion. The next slide, please. Well, accident brought Tycho Brahe, the Danish nobleman, and Johannes Kepler, the German, together in Prague. Tycho Brahe had been given an island, the island of Svein, between what is now Sweden and Denmark, on which to build his famous observatory. The king of Denmark, who was his patron, died, and the new king, Christian the IV, quarreled with Tycho Brahe, but also quarreled with most people on the island of Svein, and so Tycho Brahe went to the court of the Holy Roman Emperor Rudolf II in Prague just before 1600. The Reformation, of course, was in full swing. Martin Luther pinned his 90 theses on the church door in Wittenberg in 1517, and by the middle and late 16th century, the Roman Catholic Church had done something to reform itself at the Council of Trent, and had launched the Counter-Reformation, and the Habsburgs in Austria and Spain took up the Counter-Reformation, and Kepler, who was teaching at a Protestant school in Styria in Austria, in Graz, found that life was getting a bit hot, and so he too went to the court of Rudolf II in Prague, and there became Tycho Brahe's assistant. Tycho Brahe died in 1601, leaving Kepler to work out the orbit of Mercury and of Mars. Other people, of course, were getting interested in the Copernican system, and among these was Galileo, but also one or two Englishmen, and I'll speak of them a little later. The Reformation had resulted in Copernicus's ideas spreading to Britain, and in fact Edinburgh University taught the Copernican system very early. Galileo had read a book by Kepler and corresponded with him, and came to believe in the Copernican system, but he didn't become famous in Italy until hearing about the discovery of the telescope in Holland in 1609. He turned the telescope on celestial objects, and here in this painting is he's showing two skeptical cardinals, two of his discoveries. The top one is his discovery that the terminator between the light and dark areas of the moon is not a circle. In other words, the moon has topography. And that, of course, was one of the reasons why he got into difficulties, because the scholastic philosophers of the time argued that from first principles, according to their lights, that the sun and moon were heavenly bodies, therefore had to be perfect, and Galileo was showing that the moon was not a perfect sphere, and of course his discovery of sunspots a little bit later on showed that the sun also was imperfect. The lower sketch, of course, is the discovery of the four satellites of Jupiter. And these discoveries excited the population of Italy, and he put forward, he wrote a little book about them, and for the first time made clear that he believed in the Copernican system. One of his most important arguments is that he could understand the objection to the Copernican system that the Earth was in motion and carrying, apparently, because gravity wasn't known, carrying with it the orbiting moon. But Galileo, in this discovery of the Galilean satellites of Jupiter, saw an example of a planet which even the Ptolemaic astronomers said was moving. He saw that that was carrying through space orbiting satellites. And so this was one of a number of arguments which convinced him of the truth of the Copernican system, and Galileo rather quickly popularized these ideas. Still, the Church of Rome made no move against the De Revolutionibus Orbium Celestium. But they have been rather bothered by heresy, which involved a person who believed in the Copernican system, and I'll refer to Giordano Bruno in a moment. Next slide. On the left you see Galileo's sketch of the moon with the irregular terminator. It's rather interesting that in relatively recent years it's been demonstrated that an English astronomer, Thomas Harriot, who was in the scientific circle of the Earls of Northumberland, either discovered the telescope independently or heard of its existence, and in the same year as Galileo, rather earlier, discovered sunspots, the moons of Jupiter, and drew a very much better map of the moon than Galileo's. This, of course, is Galileo's sketchbook showing his discovery of sunspots. The next slide, all in 1609 to 1610. His telescope, of course, wasn't good enough to resolve the rings of Jupiter, but sometime around 1610 or a little bit later, Galileo observed the phases of Venus, shown in the top, and argued that that the phases of Venus were an argument in favor of the Copernican system. This wasn't entirely true because Tycho Brahe had a kind of modified Copernican system in which you get phases. This is a picture of Galileo in this period, leading up to the events of 1615 and 1616, when the Copernican theory became of interest to the Inquisition. The next slide. Now, in understanding the events of 1615 and 1616, I think it is important to mention Bruno. He is not mentioned in the Pope's commission's report for rather obvious reasons. Bruno, believing in the Copernican system, he visited England, by the way, and had discussions with Thomas Harriot, rather foolishly went back to Rome, but he was the first person to reason on the basis of the Copernican theory that the stars were very probably like our sun, and he then speculated that just as our sun has planets, so the stars would have planets. Very up-to-date idea, of course, with the discovery of dust rings around stars like Beta Pectoris. The next slide. And he wrote two works in which he put these ideas forward. And then, of course, really got himself into trouble by suggesting that the planets around other suns might be inhabited. And so it's not perhaps surprising that he was brought to before the Inquisition, and the poor man was burnt at the stake in 1600. The next slide shows the square at Rome where he was burnt. Now, a very important gentleman comes into the story, Bellarmino, the foremost theologian of the day, who'd taught astronomy and philosophy at the University of Louvain, was on a member of the Inquisition, and it was natural for one or two of the people who started writing about the Copernican system, in particularly a Dominican called Father Foscarini, to send his manuscript to Bellarmine, if you like, for vetting. And Bellarmine writes back that if you choose, as I've always understood Galileo to choose and Copernicus to choose, to write about the heliocentric system purely as a mathematical model to improve and perhaps simplify the calculation of the position of the planets, then there can be no harm in that. But Bellarmine goes on to say that if the Copernican system is written about as physical truth, then it does appear to collide with theology, and in particular the God's word and the truth of the Bible appears to be threatened. And then Bellarmine goes on to say that he would himself take the Copernican theory as physically true if a proof of its physical correctness had been shown to him, but he said that he hadn't seen one. Galileo, at his trial, said that the Copernican system explained the tides, but Galileo was, in fact, was wrong about that. Then Bellarmine goes on to say, but suppose at some future time someone does come up with a proof of the Copernican theory, then theologians would have to go back and reinterpret the Bible, reinterpret those passages which, like Joshua's famous command to the sun to stay still, appeared to imply that the earth was stationary. Galileo was rather truculent, and he wrote to a pupil and friend, the next slide, who had reported to him, Castelli, that at dinner with the Grand Duchess of Florence, an argument had arisen about the Copernican system, and Galileo had been defended by Castelli, and the Grand Duchess asked, of course, for proof, and Galileo wrote a rather persuasive letter to Castelli, and later on to the Grand Duchess, putting the case. This got into the hands of some rather reactionary and jealous astronomers, Jesuit astronomers, and the whole matter was reported to the Inquisition. The Inquisition at first dismissed the case, but the Pope at the time was not intellectual and had expressed strong views about heresy, and as a result of this, the Inquisition finally put Copernicus's book in 1616, that is almost 75 years after its publication, on the index of forbidden books, or rather, to make it to be more accurate, it caused Copernicus's book to be withdrawn from circulation until it was corrected, that is, until it was made clear again that the Copernican theory was a mathematical model and not physical reality. People took it that this action of the Inquisition had been a rebuke to Galileo, who was openly advocating the Copernican system, and they assumed that the Inquisition had told Galileo to cease his advocacy. Galileo was sensible enough to write to Cardinal Bellarmine and ask for an interview, and the Cardinal, who, as you've seen, had quite a subtle mind, drew these careful distinctions and told Galileo that there was no harm in his teaching the Copernican system, providing he didn't go overboard. And Galileo asked the Cardinal to write him a letter to that effect, which the Cardinal did. Soon after, the Cardinal died, and somehow in the archives of the Inquisition, a rather damning instruction was filed prohibiting Galileo from teaching in any way the Copernican system, and this was one of the important prosecution documents in the trial of Galileo in 1633. Now, the next slide. Galileo set about writing his famous work, The Dialogue of the Two World Systems, and it was in the form of a discussion between an advocate of the Copernican system and a defender of the Ptolemaic system, and a rather simple-minded layman. And at this time, to Galileo's delight, the new pope was elected, who in fact had tried to stop the Inquisition from moving against Copernicus's book, and this was Urban VIII. And Galileo immediately went to Rome, and apparently the Pope, who had been friendly with him as a cardinal, encouraged Galileo in this great task. Galileo was quite a polemicist, and he makes the Simplicitas seem rather a fool in this dialogue. And one argument which has been put forward to explain why, after the publication of this book, which did receive an imprimatur permission to publish by Father Riccardi, the master of the Sacred Palace, it was one of the reasons that has been put forward for the Pope suddenly acting against Galileo and bringing him to trial in 1633 was that the Pope, in these interviews with Galileo, always cautioned him to be careful at the end of his book to insert an argument which the Pope himself had invented, which was that even though it appears that all the evidence is in favour of the Copernican system, don't forget, Galileo, that God is so clever that he could have arranged the solar system so as to appear to human beings as absolutely in line with the heliocentric system, and yet God had made it work in quite a different way. And unfortunately, Galileo, at the end of his book, put these very words of the Pope in the mouth of the simpleton. That is one theory of why Galileo got into trouble. The next slide. This is Cardinal Barberini, the originally friend of Copernicus, a very cultivated man. He wrote poetry, and he became Urban the Eighth. And this is Galileo, rather earlier than, well, about the same time as Barberini's accession to the papacy. The next slide. In the year 1633, Galileo was brought to trial as a result of the publication of the Dialogue of the Two World Systems, and the accusation was not one of heresy, because, as I explained, the Inquisition in 1616 had not declared the Copernican theory heretical, but simply had said that it appeared to conflict with certain biblical passages indicating that the earth was fixed, and that it was to be withdrawn for this rather subtle correction to be made. The prosecution dug out of the Inquisition archives this fake injunction of 1616 prohibiting Galileo from teaching the Copernican system in any way whatever. And as I explained, Copernicus, knowing the ways of Rome and governments, one might say, had taken the precaution of obtaining a letter from the famous Cardinal Bellarmine, in which the Cardinal puts an entirely different face on the attitude of the Inquisition towards Galileo. So Galileo was quite able to defend himself, but in the end, the prosecution, of course, insisted that he abjures, that he says that he has never believed the Copernican system, and he was condemned to imprisonment. The Pope immediately revoked the sentence and substituted house arrest, and for a while the old man was looked after by the Archbishop of Siena, and I'll show you in the next slide the famous house. Wait a minute. Well, the person here, Campioli, was secretary to Urban, supported, like many other people, Galileo, and was banished to some parish in Naples for getting on the wrong side of Urban. The next slide. This was the famous house, now, of course, a museum, where Galileo lived for the rest of his long life. And wrote perhaps his most important work, in which he really established the fundamentals of dynamics. Next slide. Now, the next few slides, which I'll go over quickly, show the meeting of the Pontifical Academy when the Pope announced the findings of his commission, and I will summarise them in a moment. The room where these formal audiences are held and attended by members, you see, of the diplomatic corps and the cardinals and bishops resident in Rome, is the Sala Regius, and on the wall are murals celebrating the various victories of former popes. Triumphalism is rampant in the Vatican, of course. And here, actually, you see the Battle of Lepanto, when the French and Venetians beat back the Turks in the early 17th century. This is a very interesting mural showing the famous confrontation of an early pope with the Emperor of Germany, Henry IV, in the year 1080, when the Emperor was summoned over the Alps in the middle of winter, was kept waiting outside the castle high up in the Appalachians, where the Pope was at that time residing as guest of a lady, who I think you can see her, the Countess Matilda, and the Emperor is on his knees before the Pope. I don't know, is there a pointer? So this is the castle of Canossa in northern Italy, and the Pope, you see, is on his throne. The very powerful Emperor of Germany, Henry IV, the Holy Roman Emperor, is there, and the Countess Matilda of Canossa is there. And all around, there are such examples of the triumphs of previous popes. This is the welcome in Rome of the daughter of Gustavus Adolphus, the Pope's chief enemy in the 30 Years' War, and she converted to, Christina converted into Catholicism, and so on. Now, other theories about why the Pope acted in 1633, of course, were not dealt with by this commission. One of them is in a book called, published recently, called Galileo the Courtier. It is simply that all these scientists had to have patrons at that time, and Galileo got caught up in intrigue in Rome. Another theory is that Galileo was not being tried for his support for the Copernican system, but had been reported to the Inquisition as having heretical ideas about atoms, which theologians, knowing that atoms are indivisible and indestructible and so on, became worried by writings, these early writings about atoms, because they thought that it undermined the doctrine of transubstantiation. And the argument of this book by Redondi is that the Pope was in fact trying to protect Galileo from death by arranging that the Inquisition should try him on a very much less serious charge than theological heresy. But the idea that I must say I favour is that 1633 is the critical year in the Thirty Years' War, which began in 1618. And for a while, the Catholics in Germany were triumphant. And the Pope got worried that the triumph of the Austrian and Spanish Habsburgs was upsetting the balance of power. And in fact, France intervened in support of the Protestants in Germany. And the Pope apparently, in an attempt to preserve the balance of power, even negotiated with Gustavus Adolphus in Sweden. Gustavus had landed in Pomerania in 1632, and by 1633 had occupied the whole of Germany. The Catholic cause was temporarily in complete defeat. The Spanish cardinals attacked Urban for his role in intrigue in Germany, and attacked him for supporting the wrong side. And it seems to me likely that Urban was looking around for any way to very clearly assert the truth, or to support his, he was looking around for any way to support the ideas of the Counter-Reformation. The next slide. Well, here you see the Pope inducting new members of the Academy. Of course, the Academy, the selection is made without religious considerations. And Professor Odo from Japan, space scientist, you see his wife here. The next slide. Here is the Pope addressing the meeting concerning the commission report. What the Pope said was, he attempted, of course, to say that there was no evidence that any side in the controversy had acted improperly. He said correctly, of course, that there was no meeting of minds between the scientists feeling their way in this entirely new realm of investigation and the theologians and the scholastic philosophers still rooted in the ideas of Aristotle. And he also made the point that Bellarmine made, he quoted Bellarmine, that the Pope made the point that at the time there was no clear proof of the Copernican system. I've said in the abstract that one must remember, of course, that it's only in this century that an attempt has been made, particularly by Sir Karl Popper, to understand the scientific method. And in my abstract, I asked the question, what should Galileo's defense have been? And if I could have the lights for a moment, I'll read a very interesting extract from a philosopher and naturalist who happened also to be a statesman, Field Marshal Smuts. And in 1924, he was president of the South African Association for the Advancement of Science and took as his theme the various fields in which South African scientists could make a contribution of world importance, particularly, of course, the study of the southern skies. And Smuts turns to from natural history and astronomy to geology and refers to Wegener's theory. And he says that this theory has been put forward, and Smuts declaims all competence to decide whether it's true or not, but then goes on, the value of a hypothesis often depends not so much on its truth as on its fruitfulness. A hypothesis may, in the light of further work, prove to have been wrong, but in the meantime, it has served to open up new avenues of investigation. And I hardly need to go on and explain how Smuts thought that African geology could contribute to a discussion of Wegener's theory. And I believe that Galileo's correct defense should simply have been, in the light of what Smuts said and Karl Popper, who of course went much further than Smuts, Galileo should simply have said, I do not know whether Copernicus's theory is physically true or not, but that hardly matters because I think it is clear that it opens the way to new advances. And he could, of course, have said, and in Germany, Kepler has demonstrated the three great laws of planetary motion. Could he have done it if he tried to derive these laws from the complex Ptolemaic system? The next slide. I end by referring to the fact that only 100 years later was the clear kinematic proof of the Copernican system. Copernicus himself realized that if the Earth was orbiting the Sun, the nearby stars would appear to move from side to side relative to stars further away. This is stellar parallax. Copernicus knew that it had not been observed, but made the great guess that the reason it hadn't been observed was that these stars were too far away. And it wasn't until Bessel in 1820 demonstrated stellar parallax that this very clear proof of the Copernican system was obtained. The other interesting proof, which had not been predicted, was stellar aberration. And this was discovered quite accidentally by the third astronomer Roy Bradley, who in determining with a telescope very accurate positions of the stars, noticed that they all performed small orbits in the sky, small circles or ovals, and explained it by the fact, which is of course familiar to all of us, that if you're moving against the rain, the angle at which the raindrops come is different from if you're stationary. And this discovery, purely observational discovery of Bradley, was very quickly explained by him in terms of the motion of the Earth around the Sun. The next final slides show that in Kew Gardens, there is, in London, there is a plaque on the ground recording his discovery, because he did it in a house now marked by the sundial. Thank you very much.
Zach, can I turn the floor over to you for questions, et cetera?
Yes. Why don't you take a few questions?
Well, okay. And also, there's coffee and donuts, courtesy of Bernie Peltier. Okay. Are there any questions for Professor Runcorn?
I did mention in the abstract that I find it very puzzling that the beginning of geology, modern geology, and we're celebrating this year the bicentenary of the publication of James Hutton's theory of the Earth. Actually, the next pair of slides, I think, show when... Oh, well, pass over that. The, this is, of course, the famous unconformity of the Devonian on the Silurian at Sicker Point, just north of Berwick. And this, of course, was discovered by and described by James Hutton. And it's puzzling to me that the beginning of geology came 300 years after the publication of Copernicus's book. And yet, of course, all you needed to found geology was reasoning, Ken probably can give an opinion. It may well have been, of course, again, the universal acceptance of the Bible as giving a true version of the creation. And so the, of course, James Hutton was attacked when he first brought out an outline of his theory in 1785. He was attacked by one of the followers of Archbishop Usher, and it was, you know, to buttress his argument that he, with Playfair and others, went along the coast of northeast England to find a very clear example of the ideas that we've been putting forward.
I was going to say, Dr. Whittam is formerly Director General of the Earth Physics Branch and also a former ADM in Energy, Mines, and Resources, and we would probably consider ourselves geophysicists, so maybe we can't answer the question about why geology didn't
Sorry, sir, that is southeast Scotland, not northeast England.
I'm well definitely. I had a cold anyway, so I'll come and listen. You're wanting to?
I'm from Edinburgh, so
yes. Yes. But if you want, you're going to make a statement about Hutton.
No, no. It was just, you said it was in northeast England.
Oh.
Oh, you mean it's in Scotland?
It's in Scotland.
I have some questions.
Yeah.
You know, don't you have really a conflict in these matters? A conflict between what people suppose to be facts. For instance, I'm not a geophysical geologist, I must say, but I know so much about it. Wegener, he was, the theory of Wegener was dismissed because seismologists thought that the seafloor was too rigid to allow for this subduction. And of course, this was very factual business. I mean, they couldn't indeed prove that the seafloor was too rigid. And isn't that always just the same as this whole Galilean business?
That is quite fair. I mean, Galileo was attacked by some other scientists, particularly over the question of sunspots. You see, Galileo was believed that the sunspots were on the sun and that their motion showed the sun was rotating, and the observations were disputed by other astronomers, and I think Galileo was liked to ridicule people, and he wrote a book dismissing this other poet. And saying that Galileo had seen sunspots first, you know. And so there were various conflicts of personality involved.
I should explain, John Boyer was our chief draftsman for many years here at the observatory in the Earth-Physics branch, and he's got, you have a work of art down in the National Gallery with the mirrors.
Yes. What kind of evidence was the Ptolemaic view of the solar system based on?
What kind of evidence?
How did that arise? The geocentric system.
You mean in Copernicus's time? Copernicus was convinced of the truth of the heliocentric system. But mainly because it gave what he felt was a simple explanation of the astronomical phenomena of retrogression of the outer planets.
Yeah, no, but my question is, why did people so long believe in the geocentric?
Why did people believe
in the
geocentric?
Yeah.
Because it is obvious. The modern human beings, of course, never look at the sky because they live in towns, but the ancient peoples saw the notions of the stars. And the rather more complex motions of the planets, but the planets do go round. And so I think it was common sense. And Copernicus was undoubtedly worried because apparently, when his ideas leaked out, there was some carnival in the local town, and someone dressed up as the mad astronomer, thinking that the Earth was hurtling through the sky and you know, dropping trees off in its route.
Dr. Ron Niblett and Professor Runcorn have known each other for many, many years, but I never recall you discussing
I'd like to offer a theory on the Ptolemaic system. It's a very powerful tool.
It served
navigators for a good 2,000 years.
Yeah.
And it is a hypothesis that's very pragmatic. It works.
Yeah.
And it works to the accuracies that you need to get from A to B.
Yeah.
And certainly the Arabs have made very, very good use of this.
Yeah.
And
in fact, of course, one thing that the Pope said, which is quite relevant, is that perhaps I can quote it accurately so that I don't misinterpret what he said, but in Galileo's time, to depict the world as lacking an absolute physical reference point was, so to speak, inconceivable. And since the cosmos, as it was then known, was contained within the solar system alone, this reference point could only be situated in the Earth or in the Sun. Today, after Einstein, and within the perspective of contemporary cosmology, neither of these two reference points has the importance they once had. This observation, it goes without saying, is not directed against the validity of Galileo's position in the debate. It is only meant to show that often, beyond two partial and contrasting perceptions, there exists a wider perception which includes them and goes beyond both of them. One other interesting thing the Pope said, which is kind of relevant, to the phenomena of creationism and so on, but he argues, of course, that it's rather important for the for Rome not to get into a new Galileo situation. I would have thought that it's already done so with its opposition to birth control. But anyway, the Pope points out that another crisis, similar to the one we are speaking of, can be mentioned. In the last century and at the beginning of our own, advances in historical sciences made it possible to acquire a new understanding of the Bible and of the biblical world. He then goes on to say that the rationalist context in which these data were often presented seemed to make them dangerous to the Christian religion. And certain people in the church, in their concern to defend the faith, thought it necessary to reject firmly based historical conclusions. And he goes on to say that was another Galileo problem. And of course it was, he doesn't say, and he should have done, that in fact the biblical scholars who in the Catholic Church worked in this field got a pretty
badly treated.
Yes,
they were kicked out, but then eventually,
I think it was Pope Pius XII insisted that biblical criticism was a perfectly valid
I think we have one more question for over here, and then of course later you can talk with Professor Rappel.
Have you any idea why it took 359 years to find out what everybody else knew? I mean, whatever was so obvious to everybody else, why did it take 359 years? I mean, you can take a simple pendulum to find out if the Earth is turning.
Well, it's true, of course, as the newspapers, can you go back to the previous pair of slides? It is true that the newspaper correspondents somewhat, as I said in my abstract, misunderstood what had happened. The Roman Catholic Church did, in fact, gradually rehabilitate Galileo, and I think at about the time when stellar aberration was discovered by Bradley, they allowed a publication of Galileo's collected works. And then, of course, in around 1840, when stellar parallax was discovered, publication of all Galileo's correspondence was allowed. But as I said at the beginning, I think that this Pope was anxious to make a gesture to science by having the whole controversy falling through again. But as you see, it somewhat backfired because, of course, the press came out with these headlines, Galileo was right after all.
Well, that's not what the one on the left says.
Well, before I turn the floor over to Dr. Jacobson, I just wanted to ask Professor Dick if people are interested in obtaining copies of either videos of either this lecture or the afternoon lecture, can they contact you? Okay. And how do they do that?
Telephone.
You do it later. Telephone. Okay.
Well, let me say, I think scientists ever since Galileo have always had a soft spot in their heart for anyone who stands by what he's or she is certain of in the face of a strong counter opinion in the zeitgeist of the day. And I think it's appropriate. The history we've heard of you, sir, is that you did that with continental drift. I remember looking at a map which made that very obvious that there was a thing as continental drift. I'm not a geologist. So thank you for that. And I think it's appropriate. And thank you again for the talk as well. And we'll have time for coffee and